Welcome to First Impressions, where we give you our initial thoughts on TV shows, video games, and comic books. My name is Carl Lee.
And I am Jason Headley. This week we're going to be reviewing six comic books from the week of January...
Oh boy. Six?
Yes,
five,
it's our very first...
Seven.
I think it's... I don't think it's any of those. I think it's the seventh. It's the seventh. And today is our very first impressions of the new year. So without further ado, let's get started. Birthright number four by Joshua Williamson and Andre Breslin. We are both really enjoying this book. I know Carl got caught up today and I've been caught up. Really like the big action movie. It's got, you know, this great flashback story. It's got this great family story. We're getting to see in this issue the mom and how she feels about the family and why she's so distraught because the dad always gets to go off and have the grand adventure. And the son, you know, the son who's come back is now going after what he believes to be his villain, though we don't know if that's a good guy or a bad guy because we don't know if the main character's a good guy or a bad
guy. There's a nice twist to that.
Yeah, there is. And I don't know that I'm loving the flashback stuff. It really pales in comparison to the present day family stuff, I think. Yeah, I mean, the flashback stuff is really flashy, but beyond that, I just, you know, it's just okay. So I'm going to give this book a 4 out of 5. We're definitely going to keep reading.
Awesome. Okay, I got Ninth Generation New from Top Cow with Stefan Sejic and Matt Hawkins, which we're fans of. And this is, you know, following along with the Aphrodite 9 storyline. It's like the whole of the Top Cow universe, really, outside of artifacts. And so this book alone combines actually both of those properties. Not that they haven't combined before so much, but this is even more so. It has all the Aphrodite 9 characters that were introduced in Aphrodite, and then it combines all the artifacts from the artifacts book. And so it's a pretty grand concept and scheme. But anyways, it's in the future, so it's very high-tech, sci-fi, fantasy-ish, with cyborgs, and it's very post-apocalyptic, and it's great if you are familiar with any of the old Top Cow type of properties, because they're putting them all together in this book. Not that they weren't already before, but they do a really good job of it, and I give it a 4 because I'm excited about it.
Awesome. Next up was a pretty big release from Marvel this year, The Unbeatable Squirrel Girl. I don't know, I have mixed feelings about this book. There are times I found it really adorable and cute. There were times where I felt like it's trying really hard to be something like Lumberjanes, or maybe Miss Marvel, or maybe Batgirl. I don't know, there are times where it really stands out on its own, and times where it's so silly that I feel like they're just trying to copy a style. Regardless of that, I love that this main character is not your average Marvel superhero. I love that she puts her squirrel tail in her pants so she looks like she's got this great, like, Nicki Minaj booty. I think that's great. Overall, I think I really liked it. I want to give it another chance just to see where they go with this. I think the story with Kraven was a little contrived, a little silly, but I love her character. I love her roommate and that cat, and I love her squirrel. Overall, I want to see another issue of this, so I'm going to give it a 3 out of 5.
Oh, okay. We got Ant-Man, number 1, and this is Nick Spencer, and let me get the artist right here. The artist is Raymond Rosanas. You know, we just saw the trailer for the Ant-Man new movie, and I feel like I bet the movie is in the same tone as this, or vice versa. I don't know if they, you know, had a talk with each other or whatever, but I really like the tone. Scott Lang's character is, you know, very typical underdog. You know, I have no job. No girlfriend, no money type of guy, you know? And so there's a lot to relate to, I guess. I don't know. And, you know, he has a daughter who he can't really see as often as he likes, and he has marital problems, he's divorced, you know, all these problems. And so I could totally see Paul Rudd playing this character, and I think it's a very, 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 very good first issue. And because I gave Ninth Generation 4, I would have to give this a 4-5.
Awesome. All right, and my last comic of the day is one that if you guys watch the show at all, you know that I'm in love with. I love the creators. I love everything about this. So it's no surprise that, hey, Michael, hey, James, you guys watch, and I'm really happy for that. It's no surprise that I'll be reviewing The Woods number 9 today. I tweeted out earlier today that I had to go back to issue 8 to make sure that I hadn't missed an issue, because this issue really hits the ground running as a new arc starts, kind of taking place with some time has passed between the past two issues, and that took a little bit of an adjustment period. But overall, the end of the issue is just like, I want to know more. I just want you to sit me down and tell me everything about this world, because I'm so in. I'm so sold. This book is great. If it's one of the best independently owned books. If you are not reading it, what are you doing? It's one of the best books on the market right now. Once again, no surprise here, I'm giving The Woods a 5 out of 5 stars.
Well, I'm catching up. I'm on issue 5.
Oh, there he is. See, I told you to give him the catch-up.
Green Arrow number 38. This brings in Green Lantern. I mean, I'm really enjoying this book because it really, really kind of jumps off of the TV series.
Basically a TV show.
Obviously, you know, because some of the producers are writing and everything. So, but it's always with a weird twist. Like, there's mirror characters, but there's a really good twist. Like twisting them, like they introduce Katana, and Katana's in the show now, and they introduce Green Lantern. You wonder about him, and there's Mia, who's not, you know, Oliver's sister, and there's also like Felicity, who is completely the same Felicity, and there's Diggle, and but then they introduce other elements that twist things around. So it's still kind of fun to read this. You don't know where it's going. This issue I didn't love as much as the previous two, but you still feel like it's cut from the same cloth, you know, and it's not to say the digital only stuff is bad, but it you know, I felt more likely I would read this, and so I would give it this one. I would give it 3.
Awesome,
so far,
beautiful. All right, well, we want to talk about a video game that
we've both been really enjoying. Swamp Thing number 38.
We want to talk about a video game we've been really enjoying. I know this came out about a month or so ago now, but we finally picked up, now that we have gotten through Pokemon, we picked up Persona Q for the 3DS. For those of you, quick little recap, Persona Q takes the characters from Persona 3 and Persona 4, previously on the PS2, and puts them together in an Etrian Odyssey-style dungeon crawler. That's a lot of things in one game. Does it succeed? What do you think?
I've never played Etrian Odyssey, but
you never played Persona.
Yeah, I haven't. Yeah. No, I am not the type of person who would normally want to play a dungeon crawler and think that I want to grind and stuff, but you have to be honest with yourself, and what you end up doing when you play Pokemon in an in-game like this is that you really do want to grind because you want to build. Because why do I like any of these games? Is because I want to level up my character and be strong. So in order to not be frustrated and die all the time, you have to grind to become more powerful. And so I ended up falling into that, and I do enjoy it for that, and it's kind of like Pokemon because with the personas, I'm enjoying the characterizations, but I think Pokemon's world is a little bigger and wider, so you can explore more, and these are mostly just labyrinths.
Yeah, I mean, these are like labyrinth-style dungeons. If you play the Etrian Odyssey-style games, you know that. But I think the gameplay is great. The fighting is great. It's all there. It's very Persona-esque. But the thing about this game that sticks out to me the freaking most is I love, love, love the way they've done the characters. They have these things called strolls where you basically just hang out with your characters and like get to know them more. And it's really, really cute and it's really funny. Amidst this super dark world, these characters manage to be really, really funny and their interactions are really great. And seeing the Persona 3 and 4 cast interact together are some of the best moments in the game. Seeing Konohamaru, the dog, and Teddy like interact together is ridiculous, but it's really, really funny. Seeing, you know, Junpei, who's like the ladies' man in 3, interact with the girls from 4 is really fun. I really am enjoying it so far. I'm on the third dungeon now, and I'm loving it. I can't stop playing.
Cool. Well, I mean, I got sold on, it's really for me, it really is the characters. Like, I got sold on the brand, the property, mm-hmm. and because of that, I'm like, you know, you know what I mean? It's on my cell phone now, the images, the characters.
It's all an easy
the
brand to get
now
sucked
I want
into.
To watch the anime, and you know what I mean? I want to actually see what the other games are, but it really is all about the characters. Like, I kind of really like the characters, and I play the P4 versions of the characters.
Yeah, and I play P3 characters, so that's really fun, too.
Yeah.
We get to see both sides.
Yeah, we're watching anime.
Yeah. So, as a first impression, I know we're not done with the game yet, but first impressions, what would you give it out of 5?
Oh. Well, you know, I want to give it a 3, 5, or 4. Okay. I mean, because Pokemon I gave probably like a 4 or 5, mm-hmm. you know? So it's not, I don't know if it's Pokemon yet, but as far as the gameplay, but as far as characterization and what the brand, I definitely would give it a 0.5 plus for that.
Cool. Here's what I'm going to say about it, and I know this is crazy to say because compared to a lot of reviews out there, but I am loving this game. I am loving it. You gave it a 4. I'm going to go so far as to say, you know, I'm going to use your 0.5 system. I'm going to give it a 4.5 because it's near perfection for me. We'll see what my second impression once I beat the game is, but I love it so far. So
yeah,
great
I mean,
job
I still have
us.
A far way to go. I'm just still on the first.
Yeah, you're still playing around the first
yeah,
minute,
so
you got a little bit later than me.
Yes, sir.
All right, guys. Well, that's our show for the week.
Yeah.
If there's something we're not reading, let us know in the comments down below.
Welcome back.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
We're back. We hope you had a great New Year. Let us know if there's a New Year's resolution in comics or video games or movies you want to see more, do more, play more, or something. Let us know that in the comments down below. Follow us on Twitter, at CucamongaCat, at Carl K. Lee. You can also follow our blogs, and we'll put those down below so you can check them out.
I hope that I do this,
and then you put them down there, because a lot of people do that. Like, they're right there, and then they appear. I think that's really cool. So, we will see you next week for more comics, video games, and movies, right?
Yeah, see you soon, because there's lots of new stuff coming out. All the shows are coming back.
Crazy year. Arrow and Flash are coming back.
A lot of movies.
Oof.
Yeah, it's going to be a good year.
We're ready.